edition of Healthy and Wise. Today we do have an amazing discussion going on as we talk about the effects of tobacco use. I've got such a great panel today on the show. In fact, someone here on the show actually described us as the best thing since sliced bread. Now that means things are moto here. And so still in studio, we do have former tobacco addict Hadassah Esther. We do have clinical nurse instructor Festus Kamau. And we also do have Thomas Lindy, who is from the Kenya Tobacco Control Alliance. And so we've gotten into the discussion, but moving on, we talked a little bit about shisha just before we went on a short commercial break. Thomas, let me engage you a little bit about shisha now, as we know.
Yeah.
Number one, is the law really being enforced in regards to controlling shisha? Because you still have outlets selling it. So what are we saying indirectly? How are these places still being able to operate?
I would say we have a weakness in enforcement of our law. Mm-hmm. Not only shisha, but many other laws that we have in our country.
Right.
And despite the weakness, we have seen some progress towards enforcement.
Yeah.
We have seen people being arrested mm-hmm. in this city. We have seen people being arraigned in court mm-hmm. Because of the consumption, importation, yes. and also the use of shisha in the country. Mm-hmm. But I will just urge that we can move a step higher, because mm-hmm. we are protecting the generation. Mm-hmm. We are protecting the future generation. You see this establishment that are still operating.
Yeah.
Our information or what we have is that they are owned by the untouchables in this city.
Right.
You know those big guys that...
Big wings,
you cannot touch what they are doing in the country. But despite that, we are trying to expose them mm-hmm. so that the people know that these same people mm-hmm. or our leaders that are supposed to protect us,
right.
to protect the young children, mm-hmm. to protect the future generation, are the ones selling poison to this same future generation.
Right.
And we are trying to make it clear mm-hmm. that these people, with the time, we are going to expose them. We will name names.
Yes, you will name names.
We will name names.
Okay, as you're working on your list, these mm-hmm. same people that you're trying to protect, called the youth, will also come back and say, have you thought about the job creation that has come about from shisha sales? Because when you're talking about, let's say, one pot going at 1,000 shillings and mm-hmm. a venue is able to do maybe 100 of them in a night, mm-hmm. that's 100,000 bob. We're talking about jobs, you know, for young people.
I know, you are talking about Kenya shillings, you are talking about tax.
We're talking about the farmer, you know, side of Western, who's growing tobacco.
It's true, you are talking about that.
Yeah.
But this is the same argument that the tobacco industry has been putting to us.
Yes.
They have been telling us that they are giving tax in the tune of 18 billion and above to the Kenyan economy. Mm-hmm. They have been telling us that they are paying their fair share of what they are supposed to pay to the government.
Right.
But what are they doing? Mm-hmm. They are selling disease to our people. Mm. They are bringing destruction to families, mm-hmm. breakups. Mm-hmm. And what we have as the statistics that we use, we have discovered that the amount that they are using, mm-hmm. whatever they are giving to the government, the government is in turn using 3 times
more
mm-hmm. to mitigate these effects that mm-hmm. it has brought to the country. Go to Kenyatta Hospital, go to Nairobi Hospital.
Yes.
They are rising cases of cancer.
Yes.
People are calling us to harambees, mutuchangie, and so on and so forth, so that they can be able to treat their sick people. Mm-hmm. This is disease being brought in this country.
Okay.
And we cannot compromise on that.
Right.
We'll continue speaking strongly mm-hmm. about the shisha that mm-hmm. is being peddled, mm-hmm. and more so, mm-hmm. the emerging products. I don't know if you've heard about e-cigarettes.
Oh, yes.
They are in the market also.
Yes, yes.
And the law protects us against that. The Tobacco Control Act protects Kenyans against that.
Okay.
And we'll continue to preach the same information that these are banned products. Don't bring them to our country.
Yeah.
Don't sell them to our children.
Okay.
Don't bring them even to young children, because there is an issue of secondhand smoke.
Yes.
When you go to this establishment mm-hmm. where shisha we used to... to be sold, mm-hmm. you'll find parents going there with their children, and you'll find that these young children, they are being exposed to this.
To all that, okay. Festus, you remember once upon a time there was this debate as to what seems to be deadlier, is it the shisha or is it the cigarettes? And that debate has been ongoing, that shisha isn't as deadly as, you know, the cancer stick. still the same thing. Potato, potato.
Yes. Statistics show that, the statistics that yes. we have show that yeah. one puff of shisha
yes.
that you put into your lungs is equivalent to 100 packets of cigarettes.
Is that really true?
Yeah, that's true.
That's true.
That's true. The puff that goes in, that's like 100 packs of cigarettes that you're putting into your system.
Okay, wow, yeah. very interesting. All right, let's talk about the effects of tobacco use. And, you know, there are quite a number, but I just want to pick on a few. These are what you would actually regard as the health consequences of smoking. Going blind, erectile dysfunction being quite a popular one. Fertility issues and even gum disease. Esther, were you actually worried at some point? In regards to that, and I wonder, you know, fertility issues becoming a result of tobacco use.
Actually, the truth of the consequences started sinking into my skull
yeah.
only after I had my encounter with God.
Yeah.
Before that, that didn't worry me at all.
Yeah.
Because now you see, my mind was not in my control. So yeah. I'm basically thinking the way, like we say, the devil wants me to think.
Yeah.
So I never thought about the consequences until after salvation.
Mm.
And after salvation is when now I came to terms with everything I had done to myself.
Yeah.
And I realized, my God, I have caused such immense damage to myself.
Mm.
Probably I don't even have the lungs.
Right.
Probably I don't even, I might not be able to bear those children.
Right.
Yeah, and there was all those things. And personally, I think one of the things that cigarettes did to me was really affect my teeth.
Right.
So I have terrible, terrible teeth.
Well, they don't look too bad.
Well, from the outside,
they look good.
That's just the superficial view. But when we go deeper, yeah. I know what troubles I've had with my teeth.
Yeah.
Another thing I'd like to say is that I was asthmatic and I had a really bad sinusitis
oh, wow.
at the yeah. time that I used to smoke.
Yeah.
And can you imagine, I used to end up in hospital almost on a daily basis. Well, weekly basis, let me put it that
Jeez,
way.
Yeah.
And I would always be nebulized, for those who are in the medical, I know you understand what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
I would have to be nebulized, I would have to be given intravenous injections to revive my collapsing lungs.
Yes.
Because I would go there when I'm in a completely bad shape. I never actually thought, you see, at that time I'm struggling with these small sicknesses. I never looked at it like these cigarettes were actually accentuating
yes.
the problem.
Yes.
And I remember one time when I went to the doctor who sees my ENT doctor,
yeah, yeah.
and the truth of the matter is he looked me in the face and he said, if you don't stop smoking, this situation will not stop.
Yes.
I'd already had two major surgeries on my nose because mm-hmm. of a growth in the nose.
Oh, wow.
And after that, he just told me, you know, you need to stop. Then I remember one time I was in the U.S. and I got a major, major attack.
Yeah.
And I had to be taken to hospital in the night by my sister and my brother-in-law. And I remember my brother-in-law looking at me from the hospital bed as they put all the oxygen and all those things.
The masks.
The masks. And he just said to me, you know, one way of just getting out of these problems, and he said it with a very innocent face, is just stop smoking.
Yeah.
And believe me, that sank. I came back home with a renewed vision.
Yeah.
I was saved at that time,
yeah.
but I was still struggling with this cigarette smoking.
Yes, yes. And now salvation doesn't mean that you stop.
No. Yeah. Salvation does not mean that you will stop things you are doing.
Yeah.
No. It doesn't
yeah.
happen like that. It's not magic.
Yeah.
It's a process.
Right.
It's a process of sanctification
yeah.
that happens
yeah.
after your salvation.
Yeah.
And that's one thing people need to know, because they look at saved people and think, are you still doing that? Being saved does not mean sinless. It means you are a sinner that has been saved.
Yes.
So now you have just been attracted to the grace of God that can help you to beat some of those things you're struggling
right.
with. I came home and I remember I listened to those words were replaying in my mind
yes.
that you need to stop this thing.
Right.
Then you will be free from the sicknesses.
And true to the word.
And
when
true
you stop.
To the word,
yeah.
I actually went from smoking the 15, 20 cigarettes
yeah.
to now I was doing a kawan.
Yeah.
You know?
A kawan.
Or a kahaf.
A kahaf.
And believe you me, within that same season.
Yeah.
I quit smoking
okay.
because now my mind had
renewed.
It
yeah.
was renewed.
Yeah.
So there has to be some renewal of the mind. You listen to the
yeah.
word,
yeah.
but then you tell yourself, what have I had?
Yeah.
That I'm going to die.
Yeah.
God wants us to have a long life, but you can shorten your own life by the things you are doing.
Wow.
So I had a renewed vision towards my own life, and I said, hey, I'm not going to die.
Okay.
I'm not going to die.
All right, Festus, let's drive this point home, because sometimes the way to actually get through is to actually see what manifests from all this, you know, from your addiction. Yeah. You know, she's talked about how she was struggling, you know, her lungs were literally collapsing and all that. Yeah. What else have you actually seen as a clinical nurse, the effects of tobacco use, prolonged use especially?
So one of the major effects, and this is a common occurrence, which you're dealing with every now and then, especially for those who have smoked for long, and I mean heavy chain smokers, their lungs get so much affected to the point that their lungs expand and they cannot come back. So they get ballooned.
So what ideally is happening now?
Yes. This ballooning causes what we call chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. And these people get depleted of oxygen. And what happens is their body just reverses. So their triggers is now no longer oxygen, but the carbon dioxide. And these people are in and out hospital. So what you're talking about is, one, they're wasted time. Secondly, economy affected. So resources. Thirdly, family members, because they have to bring them to the hospital. And thirdly, me as a family member, I'm affected. And if you smoke near me, so I'm a side or a secondhand smoker. So I'm also at the same risk that you're exposed. So I'm not, I mean, those effects are, you know, chain.
It's bigger than we see.
And the other thing, and this comes because we don't put sit down and make cost calculation. We don't do that. We only look at the thing of my friend Esther, we've grown up together with her since we were young. And she doesn't mind, you know, today's sponsoring me the packet. Tomorrow it's me
in terms of idea.
And you know, when you take this thing, we feel nice, high, we're able to do many things. And I mean, but we don't sit down and make calculations of what happens.
Right.
Or the things that will come out of this just one pack that I have done. Turning from chilling to addiction to the effect of trying to stop. Because as she just said, it is not easy to stop. People just start and they just go back again because of this inability to stop because of the effects again. So, and health effects, I mean, are not necessary to the lungs. But many other things. Cancer is on the rise. Pneumonia. People are still coming to the hospital with pneumonia. Asthma. I mean, I'm just
hearing
I can't believe that she was asthmatic.
And she still went on to have a cigarette.
And she couldn't you know, associate with, I take a puff, I am admitted because of my asthmatic attack. I mean, I can't.
But then that's serious. The fact that you even actually, you can even identify what's harming you, but you're still taking
it. That's what is called, that's what is called bondage. When you're in bondage, is you cannot see, you're blinded to see what is destroying you. That's when we say, in the local language, our language, we call it an addiction. But in the spiritual language,
it's
we
bondage.
Call it bondage. And for you to go free, you need to be removed out of that bondage. You need to free yourself from that bondage. Because you are not seeing that this thing is killing me. You understand? So that's why you can't blame a smoker and say, Yanni, you didn't think that this thing is affecting your
life. You couldn't think.
It's not as simple as that.
What about those who are actually living with smokers? You just mentioned secondhand smoke. Let's talk a little bit about that, because maybe if I'm living with you and you're the smoker, I'm not really thinking about it. Like, it's not my problem anyway. But what do you have to actually say about that? You know, especially from a medical perspective.
Yeah, the first thing you have said, and it's good everyone to know, if maybe it's my wife who is smoking. I am exposed, my child is exposed. And we are all of us exposed to the same risk that her as a primary smoker is exposed. Now, once to our young children who are growing, if they're exposed to this smoking, And some of the risks they have is that, remember, for them, like, they are developing,
yeah,
and their lungs are developing. So you can imagine for them being exposed to this smoke at a very young age, mm-hmm, and how much it's going to do to their lungs, mm-hmm, even though they are not, you know, directly smoking.
Yes.
But they get, they get the same risks.
Yeah.
In fact, for them, mm-hmm, when you look at their age or, yes, their ears, uh-huh, that they will need to get into the actual risks,
yeah,
actually shorter than if I started when I was an adult,
right,
when my lungs,
yeah,
have really developed.
Yeah. Yeah.
So secondhand smokers, and I think most of the time what we do is that you're like, okay, it's my wife, and
you brush it off.
Just brush it off.
Yeah.
Just because you want to
keep the peace.
Keep the peace.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I think it's good we know.
Yeah.
And me as a husband, I should be able to come out and help my wife.
Yeah.
Anyway, she doesn't smoke.
Yeah. FYA, yes.
Yeah. So,
yeah.
But it's good. You know, as family members, let's come up together and we help. Let's not judge, she's saying.
Yeah.
Because it's not an easy thing. Yes, they started.
Okay.
But let's not get this hammer and knock it to their head.
Yes.
If you don't stop, I'm going to get out of this thing.
Okay.
Amen.
Thomas,
yeah.
So as the Alliance, and of course you're about creating awareness, even one of the tags even we have on our screen is about how, you know, tobacco use on the rise amongst women and the youth. What are you really doing on the ground to actually get these curious minds to, you know, more or less not even stick their fingers in that cookie jar, so to speak? Because, you know, like she even said, that's how she even started. And for a lot of people, yes, you've tried that cancer stick, but it all came out of curiosity when you were in campus, when you were in high school.
And also peer pressure,
and
maybe.
Peer pressure. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, what are you guys doing as an organization?
Okay, first of all, in Kenya, we have a constitution which protects us from some of these harmful products.
Yeah.
The constitution talks about the consumer protection,
mm-hmm,
whereby we are supposed to be protected. And also we have the Tobacco Control Act of 2007, which speaks to the same thing that he's been talking about, secondhand smokers. Fortunately, in the country, we have smoking zones, though they are not up to standard. The purpose of this smoking zone is to protect the person who does not smoke. So that if you are a smoker, you get yourself to the smoking zone, smoke there. Then after that, you get out.
Yeah.
Don't smoke outside. Previously, we had people lighting up in vehicles, public transport vehicles, and so on and so forth, in homes and in cars. But we have a law that is progressive.
Yeah.
It protects us from such harms.
Yeah.
And about children, it's unfortunate that even parents themselves, if a father, he knows very well that he's harming his children in the family, and he's just smoking around or anywhere.
Even if he has a designated spot.
We are talking to
house,
them that even if it's in your house, you get out, smoke outside there. Don't expose the future generation.
Yes.
Don't bring diseases to them.
Yes.
Get out, get somewhere else that you can smoke.
Uh-huh.
And also we encourage you to reduce as a way of maybe cessation.
Are you going to schools? Are you going to institutions?
Yeah, we are also doing a lot of awareness.
Yeah.
We are visiting schools. We have been at the CBD doing graphic health warnings.
And showing them this.
Yeah.
Images of lungs like
this. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We had a very good exercise at the archives there, whereby we had a graphic health warnings showing the effect of tobacco to every part of your body. From the hair to the toe, because
the images on cigarette packs, are a little bit extreme.
Yes,
they are more than graphic, I think.
And
but is that what it takes?
Personally, or as an organization, we are not happy because of the images.
Yes.
Because they should be clear images.
Yes.
That anyone that sees the image can be able to understand.
Oh, your issue is the clarity.
This is a lung. This is a. These are teeth, because the image are not clear.
Yeah, and they're too blurry.
Yeah, they are too blurry.
Yeah.
But anyway, they are scary. And each person, the law also prohibits that When you are buying a cigarette,
yes,
you should buy in a pack, mm-hmm, not sell of single sticks. Anyone selling single sticks to, mm-hmm, any person, mm-hmm, is breaking the law. Mm-hmm. Anyone selling single sticks to young children, yeah, under 18,
yeah,
you are breaking the law.
Okay.
So all these are policies that we have in place.
Yeah.
We have the shisha ban.
Yeah.
We have entitled to the right clean air that the Constitution guarantees to every Kenyan.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, so we literally have 5 minutes to go. And so I want to throw it now to you, Esther, and to you, Festus, in how to actually help those who want to get into the process of recovery. Maybe very quickly you can take us through how to start.
Okay.
If I've been a chain smoker, what do I do?
Okay, so the first thing is, there must be, mm-hmm, you have a will.
The will, yes.
You need a,
yeah,
will, yeah, to do that. So you're willing, mm-hmm, to stop. So that's the first thing. Mm-hmm. Now, the second thing is that identify, you know, people that you can work together, mm-hmm, and you have to be open. Mm-hmm. If I smoke and we work together with you in the same institution, and you actually know that I smoke, mm-hmm, I should see you as my help.
Mm-hmm.
And when I set my days to stop,
yes,
then it should be clear to you, mm-hmm, so that you come to me and tell me, hey, Festus, today was your set day.
Oh, so accountability.
Accountability.
Ah, okay.
Accountability,
okay,
partner.
Yeah.
That goes to the family. Mm-hmm. So I'll go to my wife, my children. They know today daddy is stopping to smoke.
Mm-hmm.
And so they are there with me.
Right.
And I know there are so many other ways of doing this, you know, medical, the non-nicotine issues,
yeah,
or nicotine
taking
things.
A patch.
Yes, taking a patch and all those things.
They don't work.
E-cigarette that is not allowed.
Yes.
There are people who are discussing around all that thing. But first of all, we put accountability settings.
Mm.
And in that accountability, set goals. So what do I want to do today?
Mm.
Simple things. Take your ashtrays away.
Yeah, that's right. Mm. Trash everything.
Trash everything.
Yeah.
Mm. Ask your children. And children are very good, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
And for men who smoke, your wives are very good.
Yeah.
Also the other side. I mean, just tell your wife today, remove all the sticks,
yeah,
that are there, and
yeah,
I'm telling you, they'll be swept off the house.
Obama did that.
So exactly. Do you feel that even from what he was saying, it was possible within a particular frame, let's say 21 days, as they say?
That's right.
Yeah.
You know, the, like he said, your will here is very important. It plays a major role. So once you've determined that in your mind, I want to stop, and you actually know that this is the right decision, now you start working towards it. And like he has said, I would add on to what he has said. If you are in the company of other smokers, if those are your hangout friends, then it means you have to draw yourself out.
Yeah.
Because being around them means that you'll keep on getting the urges,
yes,
as they are smoking. It's,
yeah,
not that you hate them or dislike them,
yeah,
or it's not that you're putting them in a certain category of people,
yeah,
but you're saying this is no longer healthy for,
yeah,
me, a healthy practice,
right,
to hang out with you. Let me break this thing, and until I break it,
yeah,
I can't be part of this hangout group, my,
right,
social group.
Right.
And the thing is, also knowing that being in that environment, going to those places,
mm-hmm,
will affect you.
Right.
So apart from drawing yourself out from a certain social group,
yes,
you might also have to change the places you go to.
Right.
So instead of you hanging out in those clubs now, like,
yeah,
for me, my new hangout became fellowship.
Yeah.
Became, so now,
yeah,
you know, you try to, even if you try to walk out of a fellowship and smoke outside the fellowship,
it's not gonna happen.
Somebody will look at you and think, you know, na sasa hawa, wenye madimoni. You understand? Yeah. And it happened to,
yeah,
me.
Yeah.
I used to sneak out of fellowship,
yeah,
and I would want a cigarette.
Yes.
So now looking at these people and looking at how they're looking at me meant that really I have to really be very deliberate. And I had to speak to my pastor.
Yeah.
I had to speak to him and tell him, I'm struggling with this thing.
Okay.
That,
okay.
So honesty is also important.
Okay.
You cannot,
okay,
overcome what you don't confront.
Right.
So I had to confront it. I had to tell my pastor, I'm struggling with this thing. And he actually helped,
yeah,
me.
So what I'm hearing, though, is in order to start the recovery process, it,
yeah,
really is just a mental battle. Mm. There's no taking, you know, there's no intervention in terms of medicine,
mm,
or any, you know, drug of some sort that, you know, that you're going to take that's going to help you.
Mm.
It's all about habit.
That's right.
And behavior.
Yes.
Okay.
You have to break the habit.
Okay.
Unfortunately,
all right, yeah,
many Kenyans are trying to quit.
Yeah.
I've talked about 35%,
yes,
of Kenyans,
mm-hmm,
who have tried to move away,
yes,
or to stop smoking.
Mm-hmm.
But the problem we have is that the tobacco industry and the companies,
yes,
they are still trying to advertise.
Yes.
So you will find yourself, you have decided, you have made a resolve that, oh, I want to be smoking again, I want to stop. But boom, you see an advert there, yes, attracting
enticing
to you,
enticing
you to come back.
Yeah. Okay.
So this breaking the law, and we want to speak clearly about this,
okay,
that there shouldn't be any advertisements, because many people want to move away from this very bad habit.
So stop dangling the carrot.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So I think we're going to leave it there, but I just need to thank you so much for taking time to be with us to actually talk about the effects of tobacco use. So let me start off with you, Festus Kamau Asante Sana. He is a clinical nurse instructor from MP Shah. Yes. Please greet everybody at MP Shah. I actually had my baby at MP Shah. I love MP Shah. Their maternity ward is mwah. Fantastic. Wasalimia sana. And of course, we have to thank Hadassa Esther, a former tobacco addict. See how open you're just being and telling your story. I really feel that, by the way, you've touched someone and you've encouraged someone to come out and confront.
Amen.
And confront.
And when there is God, there is hope.
Okay.
So if you're hopeless in your smoking situation,
yes,
you can always turn to God.
Okay.
He's your help in the time
all
of
right.
need.
Thank you. And of course, Thomas Lindy from the Kenya Tobacco Control Alliance. All the best as you continue your awareness.
Thank you.
Okay, Asante Sana for being here. If you did enjoy the show, please let us know. We do appreciate your feedback to our social media platforms at K24 TV on Instagram, Facebook, as well as Twitter. This brings us to the end of Alpha Jiri, but you know what? Tomorrow is a special one coming your way as we celebrate Eid. So Eid Mubarak to our Muslim brothers and sisters, and happy holidays to you and yours. My name is Chiku Kaitani, and on behalf of Paul Mbuvi, Jeff Mote, and the entire Alpha Jiri crew, have a lovely one. Enjoy the holiday.